taxes. I talked about a lot, a broad range of insects and plants and insecticides. I'm going to talk about boll weevils, one chemical, and one crop, which is cotton. That's what we deal with, okay? So I want to make sure that when I say things, y'all are, unlike Stephen, I'm grounded only in a few things. Stephen knows a lot about a lot of things. Texas Boll Weevil Eradication is a nonprofit grower initiated and funding organization. It's dedicated to eliminating the cotton boll weevil from the state in the safest, most cost-effective, environmental responsible manner possible. It was established in 1993 by the Texas legislature. It is a producer-run program. The producers pay an assessment for us to run a program. And the reason why it is governed by the legislature and TVA, and there are oversight, is because it is, producers are, once they vote in an area or a region to participate in boll weevil eradication, every producer has to be on board and involved in eradication. We cannot, five producers can't vote it in, and then the sixth producer over here doesn't want to participate. It's 100% participation once the foundation is passed. And again, it goes by the growers. But we are, our oversight is Texas Department of Agriculture. We work right underneath them and they make sure that we stay in line and do what we're told to do by the Texas legislature, follow the rules, the laws, regulations, and everything to eradicate the boll weevil. So what is a boll weevil? That is the cotton boll weevil, and there are several other weevils that we capture that are, look similar, but it's only one species. And it has a double spur on the forearm. It has a patchy clumps of hair, the stripe on its forehead, and it has clubbed antenna right here. And that's some of the distinct characteristics that we look at when making sure it is a cotton boll weevil. We have a lot of insects that are caught, and someone calls and says, hey, I've got a boll weevil that I captured in my garden. You come look at it. And I say, absolutely, but we want to know if it is a boll weevil or not. It could be, it looks very similar, but it isn't. So there are some characteristics that we can pinpoint out to make sure it is a cotton boll weevil. Can anybody guess why eradication is possible for the cotton boll weevil? Eradication is zero. So if we're going to eradicate something, we've got to get rid of every one of them. Any guesses on how that's possible? Get rid of cotton. Absolutely. If you didn't have the cotton, you wouldn't have the cotton boll weevil.
And we'd all be sitting here naked.
Is that funny? Well, there's a couple reasons why it is possible for us to eradicate the cotton boll weevil. First and foremost, the only plant that it can reproduce in is a cotton plant. So if we find every cotton farmer and every cotton field and we treat it for boll weevils, it's possible that we could eradicate the cotton boll weevil. It can only feed on cotton plants to survive. And in the same scenario, if we know where all the cotton fields are and we have a program regarding those cotton fields, we can eradicate the boll weevil. I will say there are a few plants that have been discovered that the weevil can feed on to sustain life. I'm not so sure that they can reproduce in it, but it'll feed on it just to sustain life. The scarlet globe mallow is one of those plants. I've looked for it around here. I've never seen it. I heard that somewhere around Claiborne County, there might have been some at one time. We've never found it, so it really has no other plants that would have been an issue for us as far as us spraying cotton fields and not being able to eradicate the weevil.
I'm just being around
thousands and thousands of years. In fact, it came into Texas in 1892. It was first discovered, and it came in through the lower Rio Grande Valley, the very tip of Texas. And when it introduced, over 20, 30 years, it moved from Texas, and it moved to the East Coast, and it moved to the West Coast. Mexico. So,
it doesn't bother plants that are related to plant families?
No. Like okra? So, I'm worried. It can't feed or reproduce in it. So, as the, since you asked that question, as the weevils emerged, it became the number one pest that crop, cotton farmers, challenge, were faced with to try to grow a crop. In fact, there's a lot of places in Texas that no longer grow cotton, but there's remnants of pastures, cotton being grown in that area. Looking Lock, Texas, everybody heard of Looking Lock? Know where that's at? You know there's a gin behind there? Walk around and drink all the beer, walk down, there's a gin on a steam engine still there. There was cotton being produced in that area, and, I would venture to say more than likely the boll weevil got so bad there that the farmers there chose to grow another crop and just get out of the cotton. There's a lot of little cotton gins that are around. So, boll weevil has been a problem for many years. In 1970s, research begun to eradicate the boll weevil program. There was actually a $50,000 reward if anybody could come up with a way to eradicate boll weevils. And, I won't be the one to receive it. But anyhow, in 1970, the eradication with USDA began in the East Coast and West Coast, and they started eradicating the weevils from east to west, and basically pushed them all the way back down into the very tip of Texas, into right there, and that's where the weevils are today. Going back to Texas boll weevil eradication, our state is divided up into regions, into maintenance areas, and we have a West Texas maintenance area, we have an East Texas maintenance area, and then we still have an active eradication program, which is the Lower Rio Grande Valley. And the reason why these two are maintenance areas is because we eradicated the boll weevil there, and they become eradicated and non-functional, I mean, eradicated and suppressed, weevil suppressed, and functionally eradicated, that they're now in a maintenance area, where instead of active eradication, and I'll talk about trap densities here in a little bit, they reduce the number of traps that they have that are around the fields. They're no longer spraying for weevils because they haven't detected any weevils. So they're basically monitoring those fields for any weevils that may come in through ditch hygiene or transportation or other means or methods that may come in. Because the weevil will migrate from south to north. They will hitchhike on equipment, cotton equipment, harvesting equipment that's down here. It's not clean properly before moving north. They could relocate weevils in a northern area. No farmer wants that. I told you this was a grower-run program, and they're paid for it. The assessment in this region number two right here was $23.14 an acre. So whatever acre of cotton the farmer planted, they had to pay that amount of money to boll weevil eradication to eradicate the weevils. Very expensive program. Today, that has changed. As we eradicated the boll weevil, we are not spraying anything. We're not hiring any crop dusters to spray anything. And that was our two largest expenses to eradicate the boll weevils, was to spray anything out. So now that we've reduced that, we've reduced our two biggest expenses. So now we don't have to spend that much money. We were able to reduce the assessment that the farmer has been paying all these years to just to monitor for boll weevils now. So currently, this last year, we changed to a per bale assessment. And each grower that grows a bale of cotton pays $3 into boll weevil eradication. That's where they are as of today.
What about when the bale gets bigger?
With the bale 500 pounds?
Well, yeah, the bale used to be.
Yeah. I don't know that they get that close to, but it's average bales, 500 pounds, so I guess they go up what's sold at the warehouse. Believe it or not, I have a broad boll weevil trap, and y'all are welcome to pass that around, just a little visual aid of what you've probably seen these around the cotton fields. 5-10 years ago, there was a lot of them. You notice probably not as many now. That's because we eradicated the boll weevil and we're starting to reduce our trap density around there. And it's basically like a fish trap. The weevil gets up in that cone, gets in that glass, and it looks on the outside trying to get out, and it won't ever get out. We do insert a pheromone that attracts the weevil to that cone, but we also insert an insecticide strip that will kill the weevil once it gets in there. So when you get something like this, you need all the help you can to kill them, because can you guess how many weevils that is? 350. Whenever the cylinder, that top cylinder, the clear cylinder that you're looking at that's right there, whenever it's full of weevils, a little over 400 weevils. So I don't know how many is on this trap. I bet it's well over 1,000.
They go up to the bottom.
They're attracted. They're coming from the ground. Yes, from inside the cup. And they can actually go in from the inside here. If you look at that cup on the side, they just go goes into a cone with a cylinder from the inside into the hose.
When was that day?
Don't tell them, probably. I've seen traps like this in 1994, when I first started working for low level eradication, when we first put out traps, and we didn't know what we were really doing, because I was one of the first employees hired for eradication. They told me I had to go put out these traps, and then a week later, I had to go and inspect them and count how many weevils were there. To my surprise, that's what I came upon. And I'm thinking, how am I supposed to collect, count all of these weevils? So we just devised a little Ziploc baggie with graduated cylinders, and we would just estimate. But obviously, we had a boll weevil problem. There was a problem in the area. Lots of boll weevils.
So is that in an eradicated area?
It's eradicated now, but yeah.
But I mean, obviously not then, but it, where those were.
Yes, there was a weevil problem in that area. The voters were tired of spraying for boll weevils and losing their top crop, what Stephen was talking about. And they voted in a program, and they wanted to eradicate the boll weevils. When I started in this zone, this zone has been established since 1996. In 1994, I started out here in West Texas at San Angelo, then I moved to far West Texas, to Plains, Texas, out here southwest of Lola, for 9 years. Started up the program there. But when I transferred to this zone right here in South Texas Winter Garden, was in the fall of 2007. And in 2008, we captured 1.5 million weevils in just this area right here. So we were in full eradication. We had fields trapped, we had plane spraying, we were spraying Milacron, Bifenon, ULB, and I've been doing some labels, or not labels, but some brochures about the Bifenon from Kiminova that they produce. If you want any information on the chemical or insecticide that we use to spray. No, not this year. This is from 13, 14, 15, 16, and 17. I didn't put the other data up there, but in this zone right here, after 1.5 million weevils in 2008, we were spraying and killing weevils. Most of the weevils were here in this Valley area, a few in Robstown, and very few in the Victoria area, because that area was really cleaned up on the close to the coast, upper coast. So we sprayed in 2000, and we reduced the population by 80 to 90% in 2009. 2010, we reduced it by 80 or 90%, 2010, 11, and 12. And in 2012, we captured 38 weevils in the whole zone. This whole area right here, we captured 38 weevils. So 2013, zero weevils all season long. 2014, zero weevils all season long. So that's where the benefits of boll weevil eradication started paying off. That's where we had no weevils. We weren't spending money on the chemical. We weren't spraying the fields. Farmers were happy. And we were starting to reduce the assessment. You know, we went to $17, then we went to $10, then we went to $3.50 an acre. So all was going really, really well. And all of the zones north of me were already eradicated. And they went through that same process. They were catching millions of weevils, and then they reduced them by 80%, 80%, 80%. And as I told you, weevils would migrate from south to north. So as we cleaned up this area, the only thing they had to fear was weevils moving from the south to the north. So when you talk about that and you explain that to all these farmers in Texas, we had farmers in Lubbock that were just as excited as us to eradicate weevils down in Corpus Christi as they were their own farms. So they know that they could potentially get a problem back in their fields if we don't take care of the weevils already. So we reduced the weevils. In 2015, we captured 73 weevils. It didn't happen until October 20th. That is way past all of the cotton production season. We already went through the whole cotton season in 2015 without catching any weevils. October 20th, the supervisor in Uvalde calls me and says, "Darryl, I think you caught a weevil." I said, "Are you sure? You haven't seen a weevil in 3 years. Are you sure you're looking at a weevil?" And it's like one of those things. Once you catch one and you've done like thousands of weevils, you don't forget what they look like. And she says, "I'm pretty sure." So I got my pickup and I met her halfway. I said, "We got to see what this weevil was." And sure enough, it was a weevil. What we had to do in this area is revert back to active eradication. We hadn't had a contractor in 2 years. We had them on standby, but he wasn't doing it for us. We didn't have any chemical in that area. We had to get it from the Little Rio Grande Valley. They were still spraying. So all of this happened in a couple of days. I mean, we were panicking. We didn't have personnel. We didn't have staff. We didn't have vehicles. We started getting rid of all that stuff. We survived. We detected the weevils. We went in there and added more traps to all of the surrounding fields. We started spraying those fields. If we had some reproduction, if we're in this Uvalde area, that's where we captured them. At that time, we were scratching our heads, where did these weevils come from? You know, what happened? Where did they come from? We didn't know. There was theory coming from the valley, migration. Did they hitchhike here before we didn't detect them, and now they're here? Or where they're coming from? But I wasn't so much worried about that at the time as I was trying to kill them to get them back down to zero, because that's what the farmers were paying us to do. So 2016, we hit an all-time high of 15,000 weevils, and that was a lot of residual weevils from the year before. You know, we caught them October 20th and we started spraying. There obviously was more weevils out there than we detected with the traps, and started spraying as late as we did. But we had weevils that went into overwintering. If you don't know, a mole weevil goes into overwintering in the fall, and it looks for brush to hide, and it builds up fat reserves from the cotton plants, and then similar to a bear. It'll go into hibernation because there's nothing to feed on in the wintertime. Then in the spring, when it warms up and the cotton, they start planting cotton, you've got volunteer cotton, the weevils will come out, and the first thing they can do is start feeding to survive. So we did put some weevils to bed that year, and they did survive, and they came back the next year, and we captured 15,000 weevils. I will say this, there was a field that a farmer did not tell us to plant cotton in that weevil area. Never been caught before, and it's not a farm like you think. You're driving out here and you see the farm, and this farm was behind locked gates in a pack behind the pasture. You didn't see from the road. I didn't even know the farm, but it was farmland back there. So we didn't have a trap. We didn't have a trap. We didn't have a map. We didn't have a trap to map. We obviously didn't spray it. So we didn't spray that field, but we sprayed every field around it. Guess what happened once we discovered that field? We wouldn't put traps on it. We caught 6,000 weevils. So over half the weevils we caught that season, right? One field, and the field wasn't only for 35 acres. So there's a little plug for Malathon. If it kills weevils, we're worried about residual, but it does work. So once we discover that, we'll clean that up. And this year, we had the full active program. We actually had to go back and hire some seasonal helpers to help us inspect those traps. Those traps that you're passing around are inspected on a weekly basis. So we inspect those traps, and we reduced the population by 1,292. And if I had to be honest about that, 750 of those weevils were caught the first week of January 2017. We left our traps out in the field over the Christmas break. And when we came back, those weevils were in there. So those 750 of those weevils were actually from the previous season. They weren't from the cotton growing season in 2017 this year, last year. So we caught those 750 of those weevils last year, which is a pretty good reduction in weevils. I think we're there. We know their weevils are there. We're monitoring them. We're prepared. And we do treat them. So we're going back, getting back to zero. Now, the reason why I really wanted to come here and show you what we do and how we do is more focused on sensitive sites. We call them sensitive sites, but Beehive is a sensitive site to us. So is a church, schools, hospitals, suburban areas where there's a lot of houses, anything like that. We consider sensitive sites, and I want to talk to you about what the foundation does regarding sensitive sites, how we go about treating fields next to sensitive sites, which also includes beehives. Last year when I reached out to Dennis, I said, look, we want to locate beehives. I mean, we know they're out there, we see them, but we our technology changed in what we do. We have live maps now that look a lot better. We use iPads. We can denote things a lot easier now than on a handwritten map that we used to have. So I reached out and we tried to locate beehives as a preventative measure if we ever did catch weevils or ever any weevils came back in this area, so we would know where they were before I put an airplane in the field and start spraying and mowing. Because one thing we don't want to do is eradicate the bees. So our technology now allows us to put little icons on our map. There's our little bee. That's just an example I pulled up. All of these fields that are here are have been cotton planted in the past. That's all we have. All we know is all the fields that have ever been planted in cotton. And if they've been planted in cotton, they're turned brown. If they plant cotton this year, we go back and we look at all these fields every week, and we'll mark it green as the cotton gets planted, and that tells us the field is cotton. A blue field is last year's cotton. We concrete. So that's a 2017 cotton field. And this year will be, it'll be blue all year long. And that's just for us a code color so we know that that was cotton last year. So the green dots around here, that's those green traps that I passed around. So there's every tenth of a mile around the perimeter of the cotton field, we put those traps to monitor for boll weevils. We inspect them weekly. And if we catch a boll weevil in one of these traps, that's what triggers us to start treating. So that's how we know where to treat, where the weevil is located. Pretty simple. There's three ways to eradicate boll weevils: mapping, tracking, and treating. We've got to map the fields, we've got to know where the cotton fields are. We have to track the fields to identify if there's a population of weevils there. And we have to treat the fields if we do find a population.
Would you treat it with the boll weevil?
Yes. Now, early eradication, when there was millions of weevils like that first trap, our trapping criteria was 2 weevils per 40 acres. So depending on, because there was weevils everywhere, we didn't treat, if we would have went with 1 weevil and treated everything, we didn't treat every acre, every week, every, I mean, we couldn't do that. Economically, we couldn't do that, wouldn't have been enough airplanes. So as you get less weevils in a program, you actually get more aggressive when you're treating. For example, if I catch 1 weevil in here, I'm not only going to spray this field, I'm going to spray that field, and any other field within a half a mile around it. Because I want to eradicate the people. I can't control them. I have to eradicate the people.
Does Mexico have a similar eradication program?
Yes, they do. They do have a program. And actually, there is a national advisory committee that has been put together for Texas and Mexico experts to help run that program. I will say that it's probably not been run to the quality and caliber as Texas boll weevil eradication has been. They've had their challenges, but they are in an active eradication and they are reducing their weevil population. And the cartel is the biggest challenge, believe it or not. Trying to operate around it is very, very challenging. So I'm going to zoom in and show you another picture of, actually keep your eye on this field right here. I want to actually go in and let you know, we're going to talk about that field here in a second. The other thing I wanted to show you just real quick, a couple of slides, is when we do spray a field, this is a green cotton field that was sprayed, and this was a cotton field from last year that was treated. When we trigger that field to treat, it turns red. If it's a sensitive field, it turns yellow. That's how when we give our maps to our crop dusters, they know if it's a sensitive field or if it's a regular field. And if it's a sensitive field that has leaves on it, I'll get into that in just a second for how we treat. But inside each plane, we require a recording device that records their flight path over and around that field. And it tells us when the chemical is on, tells us when the chemical is turned off. So we can see here is where the field was treated. This is a circle of cotton, half a circle of cotton. I don't know what was on the southern half, probably corn or milo. And these are the fields that were treated. So we can overlay his flight path on our cotton fields. So if you think your house was sprayed or you were sprayed or anything like that, there's a recording of all of his activity that tells where he flew. This just shows the chemical on. It also has an option to put the flight path on. And you see everywhere he's turning and doing like that, it's be a jumping mess. Yes, sir.
But it doesn't show the blue of the vapor.
No. No, this is a honey. This is just a recording. Their swath width on this particular airplane was 100 feet. So this little one rectangle here is 100 feet wide. And you can see he's flying and it's just recording all the way. He turns around and comes back through. It does not show drift or chemical application. It just shows when he hits his money switch, when that turns the chemical on, all it does is turn on the recording device to record it chemical on. So it doesn't control.
Pervading wind.
You can draw a pretty straight line at 150 miles an hour. The other recording device that we use is not in an airplane, but it's on a ground rig. It's on a vehicle that has a mist blower, similar to what the cities may spray with mosquitoes when you come through the alleys of your streets and blow in that fog. We have similar devices that spray to 90 degrees perpendicular to the vehicle as it drives. And the purpose of it is to trim any edges of the field where the airplane may miss. Due to power lines, obstacles in the field, tree lines, wherever it is, if that airplane cannot treat that section of the field, these mist blowers go around there and treat those edges. And our goal is to get chemical on all of the plants, because if we miss sensitive site. It's all blue because eventually it was all cotton, but let me tell you the history of it. This is a circle here, 120-acre circle. This line right here divides that circle in half, east and west. The east side of this field was planted early, as was the dry land corners. This side of the circle here was cucumbers. So this is in the winter garden, they plant a lot of vegetables. They have to pollinate their vegetables to make the crop, the cucumbers. The beehives were located right here in the cotton on that dry land corner. Early season, we put two applications on every cotton field, and when it reached Pinhead Square, you saw the picture of the square, about 4 to 6 weeks after that planting emerges, it'll start squaring. That is when a weevil can start feeding on that plant and start reproducing. Well, reproducing on the 30th square a little bit later, about a week or two later. That is when the first weevil can start feeding on that, and that is what triggers us to start spraying. We won't spray that field prior to that cotton plant reaching that maturity. So what happens? We declared this a sensitive field, and when we triggered it, it was yellow. Another one of our team members, Joel Peach, he is our environmental monitoring specialist. He is the guy that's hired for both, what we was hired to protect sensitive sites. Me and him don't get along. We like each other, but I'm here to spray and he's here not to. And his job is to protect the beehives on a sensitive field, protect the church, next to the church, protect the hospital, protect the community, protect people. And really, we get along. We work good together, but he makes the calls and I made the calls to spray and he was telling me, no, can't spray it. And here's what happened on this field right here. We had bees right here. Southeast prevailing wind, and we needed to treat it. So he gets to this field and he monitors it. He sets up dye cards inside that trap. Is there dye cards? He monitors an area around that, those beehives prior to the airplane ever getting there and prior to the spray. And he has these dye cards. I'll pass it to you out. They're oil-sensitive dye cards. There's nothing, they're pretty scratched up. You can do your thumb, right? Oil on. And Malathon is oil-based, and it'll pick up any drip. So anytime you get a drip or something like that, it'll speckle those dye cards. So he's out there setting up his dye cards. He's monitoring the wind speed, the wind direction, and of course the beehives. And he's talking to the pilot before the pilot even takes off from his airport. He says, okay, we've got bees. The pilot has the same map. He's got bees right here. It shows him where the bees are. He goes, this field is safe to spray right now. However, I need you to leave off about 500 feet on the east side of the bees. I need you to leave about 500 feet off on the west side of the bees. Okay, I can do that. So here comes the airplane. So the airplane is spraying this half of the cotton field. He's spraying this dry land because it was planted at the same time here. And then he sprayed this, and this is still cucumbers. So I'm telling you this because this is how we treated this sensitive site this year when we had to treat it. He left off 500 feet. I didn't like it. I wasn't happy. I'd rather spray every cotton plant because now we're jeopardizing weevils in this area, and it may take us a little longer to eradicate weevils. However, we didn't spray the beehives. The pilot did a very good job. He listened to Joel. So he didn't spray here. He's even left off over here. He didn't spray over the beehives. He started over here and he sprayed right there. So that is what we do to protect a sensitive site. The other thing we do to protect that sensitive site is we try to spray it at first light in the morning when the bees are less active, or at very evening before the sun goes down when it's less active. So we do that as well. We're also in communication with that bee owner. The actual guy that owns the bees is not the farmer that plants the cotton and plants the vegetables. But he actually hires this guy and pays him to bring his bees out here and pollinate his crops. So there's a person that we have to talk to. And as soon as the cucumbers were pollinated to this satisfaction, he actually removed his bees from this field. Then it became a non-sensitive field. And then we treated it just like we wanted to. So that is what we do for sensitive sites and eradication. So, when I reached out, oh yes sir.
How accurate is that location?
Extremely. On our little iPads, we have a geolocator on there, and when we have it, it's following us around. And when we tag a beehive, I mean, if we're parked right, if this is the beehive and I'm parked in my pickup right here, I can hit that bee and I can tell it to save that geolocation at my location, and that bee pops. And inside that bee is the information page where I can click on it. I get the beekeeper's name, phone number, or whatever I need. So if I have to call him or if there's any issues, we have contact with that bee.
Do you all ask the beekeeper to remove their bees?
Do we ask them to remove their bees? Yeah, we would love for them to remove their bees, but we know it's not practical on this because he was paid to bring them in to pollinate crops. So we have to work hand in hand with them. Now, and that's the biggest challenge is our communication. I want to call that beekeeper and I said, look, we need to spray. And here's what we're going to do. And he's going to say, I want to keep my bees there 2 more days. Can you wait 2 more days? Absolutely. I'll give him 2 days, let him get his bees out of there, and then I'll come spray. If he says, no, they're going to be there for the next 3 weeks, and I can't wait that long, we have a couple options. Spray early in the morning, late in the evenings. We've even been uncovered with beehives, and so we can spray so we keep the beehives contained, the bees contained in the beehives. Joel doesn't like to do that very often because he's not a beekeeper, but he will do it if we have to. Yes, in this case, we left 500 feet from the beehive to the east and 500 feet from the beehive to the west.
And is that difficult?
It depends on wind speed and direction. You know,
and then how do you know where a beehive is? How would
a bee, like, Excellent question. In this case, we see the beehive because we're driving around inspecting these traps. What I would like to know is, if y'all, and this is a street map, but right here is pasture. And right there is a house, the driveway that goes to this house. If this person was a beekeeper and had bees behind his house in a barn right here, I would not know it, because I don't see the beehive. So I probably wouldn't have treated this as a sensitive site. And if the wind was blowing straight out of the east, I would probably, if I'd known there was bees there, I'd probably not spray it, because I could wait a day or two, the wind direction may change. And if we had a southwest wind or a straight south wind, I would be safe just to spray it, because I don't even want to try to jeopardize off-target drip, you know, onto a beehive. And that is our biggest challenge with beehives. When I reached out to Dennis last year and said, look, here we've got this new system, we're locating beehives, you know, or can you tell me where the beehives are? I mean, I can see them out in the country and I can tag the ones I see, but are you willing to give up your locations? And to be honest with you, people are pretty tight-lipped. I don't know where they're at. I don't care. But we're trying to help. So I'm not there to try to find where the beehives are so I can steal your honey. I don't want to do that. I just want to know where they are if we ever have to spray them. How do you get a hold? If you want to get a hold of me, I'll let my business cards up there and I'll give you my contact information. If you'll give me your longs and lats, I can just locate them on my computer on my desktop and I can put it in there. If you can't give me that, you just give me like a street address and say there, my house is there. If you pull into my driveway, you'll see the beehives. What I did last year for Dennis, I actually drove to those locations where he told me there was bees, and I tagged them right there. I parked in the